I invite you to open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1 as we continue our study of this incredible letter. I want to start by reading the very end of verse 10 all the way to verse 14. Paul writes, "In him also we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will, to the end that we were the first to hope in Christ would be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is given as a pledge of our inheritance with a view to the redemption of God's own possession to the praise of his glory." Now tonight, we do continue our study of Ephesians by beginning to look at these last few verses of the opening section of Paul's letter to the Ephesians. What began in verse 3 with Paul giving praise to God the Father for blessing us with all of the spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus, it finishes here in verse 14. It's really one long sentence with the apostle telling us about the role that the Holy Spirit plays in our salvation. And in between these verses, 3 and 14, is just a stack of incredible truths. Truths filled with rich and profound theology about our salvation in Jesus Christ and how that theology is really related to each person of the Trinity. So in verse 4, we learned that in eternity past, God the Father chose us in Christ. In verse 7, we learn that in the present, we have redemption in Christ and all the blessings that go along with redemption, some of which Paul mentions here, the forgiveness of our sins, all of our sins, wisdom and insight so that we can comprehend and understand the doctrine of redemption and its many practical aspects, especially the knowledge of the mystery of God's will, which, as Paul tells us in verse 10, is that all things will someday be united under the headship of Jesus Christ. And then in our next study, we're going to see the role of the Holy Spirit in our salvation. He is the pledge. He is the down payment. He is the guarantee that there's more to come. He seals us as well. Now tonight, our study, starting with the end of verse 11, we'll go through verse 12, and really it is a continuation of the subject of redemption. Paul's not through with that. That is a major, major doctrine. But you're going to see there's a little bit of a different twist than we might expect. You see, in verses 7 through 10, which we looked at last Sunday, Paul has spoken of the redemption of all who are believers in Christ, all believers. But in verses 11 through 14, while still speaking about redemption, the apostle introduces a new thought. A new thought that he will develop later on in this letter. And that thought is that the blessings of redemption, note this, are for Gentile believers as well as Jewish believers. That was radical and revolutionary in the first century. For example, if you look at Ephesians chapter 2, this is what I'm talking about. He later develops this. This was new to these people. Chapter 2, starting in verse 11, "Therefore, remember that formerly you, the Gentiles in the flesh," and let me stop here and say most of the people who received this letter were Gentiles. So he says, "You, the Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by the so-called circumcision, which is performed in the flesh by human hands, remember that you were at that time separate from Christ, excluded from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers to the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who formerly were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who made both groups," speaking of Jewish and Gentile, "into one," meaning believers, "and broke down the barrier of the dividing wall." He's talking about the wall that divided Jews from Gentiles in the temple area. It's broken down. Symbolically, it's gone, Paul said. Also, Ephesians 3, verse 6. To be specific, he says that the Gentiles are fellow heirs and fellow members of the body, meaning the body of Christ, and fellow partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Now, the fact that Gentiles are in the body of Christ is something that I think we tend to take for granted these days. We don't even think about it. Why? Because the church of Christ today is made up of more Gentile Christians than Jewish Christians by far. But in Paul's day, folks, it was just the other way around. There were far more Jewish believers in the early church than there were Gentile believers. And those who were Gentile believers in the church were often looked upon with suspicion by those who were Jewish Christians, as if these Gentiles were second-class citizens. Well, in these verses, Ephesians 1, verses 11 through 14, Paul is going to begin to dispel that false notion, that erroneous view that Gentile Christians are not full-fledged members of the church, of the body of Christ, that they're not on the same level as Jewish Christians. And he does that by giving us a little foretaste of the truth that he'll develop later in this letter, as I said, the truth being that Jewish believers and Gentile believers have no distinctions before the Lord. They are one in Jesus Christ without any spiritual differences. And Paul introduces that thought here in these verses by centering his thinking once again around the doctrine of redemption. And so in these closing verses of this first section of Ephesians, the apostle, as he continues talking about redemption, gives us three more truths about redemption, all with the view of teaching us that Christ has redeemed both Jewish believers as well as Gentile believers. Now, tonight we want to look at the first of these truths about redemption. I said there are three main truths here. Tonight, the first one, which is this: we are his redeemed possession. We are his redeemed possession. Starting at the very end of verse 10, as I said, and then into verse 11. In him also we have obtained an inheritance. Now, this is a very interesting verse. It's interesting because there's more here than we might at first realize. You see, according to Greek grammar, these words can be translated two possible ways, and they're both acceptable. Both the King James Version and the New American Standard Bible translate this expression, "In him also we have obtained an inheritance." Let me say that again. In him, meaning in Christ, also, we have obtained an inheritance. Now, based on this rendering, which is perfectly fine, these words mean that we who are believers in Jesus Christ have received an inheritance. In other words, because we possess Jesus, we possess all things, because all things belong to him. That's why we're called in the Bible joint heirs with Christ. Now, certainly this is true. This is certainly a biblical truth, because the New Testament is filled, it's loaded with statements about believers obtaining an inheritance, an eternal inheritance. One very clear statement about our inheritance is found in 1 Peter 3 and 4, where Peter says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Verse 4, here's what he's saying: to obtain, we've been born again, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable, it's undefiled, will not fade away, it's reserved in heaven for you. So, certainly it can be translated this way, and if that is the way it should be in this verse, then it means that we have received an inheritance because we have received Christ. But the other way that Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11 can be translated is, in him also we were made an inheritance or a heritage. Now, in this case then, the rendering would mean that Paul is teaching that we who are believers in Christ are Christ's inheritance. In other words, we have become the Lord's inheritance in the sense that we belong to him. We've been given to him by God the Father. Now, this too is certainly taught in Scripture. If it's not taught here, it's certainly taught in other places in the Bible, because there are many verses that say that God the Father has given us to Jesus Christ, his Son. Two places where we See this as, for example, John 6:37. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will certainly not cast out. Then in John chapter 17, in fact, a number of places in John 17, which is our Lord's high holy priestly prayer, we read this, but the opening verses of John 17 tell us this. Jesus spoke these things and lifted up his eyes to heaven. He said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. Of course, he's speaking of his upcoming death. Even as you gave him authority over all flesh, that to all whom you have given him, he may give eternal life. So here our Lord is praying to the Father concerning all whom the Father has given to him, believers. So the question for us is to determine this. What does Paul mean here in Ephesians? I mean, both, whether you render it one way or another, they're both true, but we want to determine, if we can, what Paul meant here. Does he mean that Christ has become our inheritance because he belongs to us? Or does he mean just the opposite, that we have become Christ's inheritance because we belong to him? And I must say, after reading what others have said, I must say that very competent, well-respected evangelical Bible teachers are divided on what Paul means here. But in my judgment, the context indicates that Paul is teaching that we who are in Christ have become the Lord's inheritance. And I'll tell you why I came to that judgment, that opinion. You see, the very concept of redemption, the very heart of redemption, which is really the theme of these verses, is that we've been purchased by Jesus. That's what redemption means. He purchased us. He purchased us out of the marketplace of sin, and we belong to him. We read this very clearly in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, the end of chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you have been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. The price is the blood and life of Jesus Christ. In fact, if you'll notice in verse 14, while Paul speaks of us as having an inheritance, so there he speaks of having an inheritance, he also speaks in that verse as being God's own possession. Why? Because of redemption. Redemption is all about purchasing us. Verse 14 says, who is given as a pledge, meaning the Holy Spirit, of our inheritance with a view to the redemption of God's own possession. That's us, to the praise of his glory. But I think the strongest argument in favor of Paul teaching that believers have become Christ's inheritance is that he is about to tell them for the very first time in this letter that God's people are not exclusively Jewish, but they include Gentiles as well. And one of the ways, and follow the thinking here, one of the ways that God conveyed to the Jewish people in the Old Testament that they were his people is by using language in which he referred to them as his inheritance. For example, and I've just chosen a few of these, there are other examples in the Bible. Deuteronomy 32, verse 9. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the allotment of his inheritance. So there he's speaking of Old Testament Israel as his people. They are his inheritance. Psalm 33, verse 12. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom he has chosen for his own inheritance. Once again, referring to Israel, the Jewish people. Deuteronomy 9:29. Yet they are thy people, even thine inheritance, whom thou hast brought out by thy great power and thine outstretched arm. See, the point that Paul seems to be making, and he's using language to convey this, the right language, is that just as Israel has been God's own inheritance in that they belong to him, so today, believers in Jesus Christ, including Gentile believers, are his inheritance too. By virtue of Christ's death, he has redeemed them so that they belong to him. See, that is really the context here. He is talking about redemption But he is about to make a point that the redeemed are not only Jewish people who believe in Jesus. The redeemed are Gentiles, and he's using the language of us being an inheritance, the church being his inheritance, because he has used that for Israel. And the beauty and the power, folks, of this truth is that because we are Christ's possession, it not only affects the way we live, it affects the way we ought to treat other believers. This is a precious, powerful truth that we belong to Christ. See, as those who belong to him, it means that he is our Lord. He's our master. He's our sovereign. He's our sole authority. We have been bought by him, and we are his slaves. A few years ago, John MacArthur came out with a wonderful book just called Slave. Every time you see bondservant, Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, it's a slave. That's what he means. We are slaves. Therefore, our only concern in life ought to be to accept his sovereign will for our lives and to do his will and to please him. Paul said, for me to live is Christ. I love the practical way that Pastor Ray Stedman, in his commentary on Ephesians, put this truth. He said, what does this mean in practical terms? Well, it means that you and I must not complain any longer about what life hands us. It is the Father who has made that choice. He has chosen to put us where we are, to give us the problems we have, in order that in the hurt and the heartache and the suffering and the joy and the blessings and the riches, whatever they may be, the life of Jesus may be released in that situation. By that means, he destroys the old and brings in the new. And as we make ourselves available to him, moment by moment, in the shop, in the office, in the home, in the backyard, wherever we are, and as we respond with joy and love and acceptance of the situation in which we find ourselves, God is glorified. Christ receives his inheritance. He finds riches of delight and enjoyment in that. So, one of the ways we have to look at this and say, if I belong to Christ, if I'm his inheritance, then I need to glorify him. I need to obey him. I need to do whatever his word tells me to do. But secondly, if every believer belongs to Christ, then we also need to be very concerned how we treat other believers, how we treat other Christians, because they are his. In Acts chapter 20, the Apostle Paul gathered the elders from the church at Ephesus together for his final words to them. And he says in Acts chapter 20, verse 28, Luke records this. This is what Paul told the pastors of the church of Ephesus. Be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd, which means to pastor, to shepherd the church of God, note this, which he purchased with his own blood. What a profound truth. The church has been purchased with Christ's blood. Now, according to Paul, pastors need to be very careful how they shepherd the flock. You know why? Because it's not their flock. It doesn't belong to them. The flock belongs to Christ. He purchased it at Calvary. And all of us, whether you're a pastor or not, need to be careful how we treat other believers, how we speak to them, the courtesy we extend to them, the honor we extend to them, because every believer is the Lord's own possession. We show no favorites. They belong to him. We treat them with respect. They are his. Now, since we are the Lord's redeemed possession, a very valid question to ask at this point is, why did Christ purchase us? See, when we go shopping for things, if you happen to like shopping, I do, but I realize not all men do. But when you go shopping for things, we tend to look for the best buys, the best quality merchandise. We want the biggest bang for our buck, we say. But if God made a purchase based on these considerations, you know what? None of us would ever be purchased by him. Because frankly, we are no bargain. We're sinners. We're rebels. We're transgressors of his law. So then the question is, why did Christ purchase us? Well, apparently the Apostle Paul anticipated this question because he tells us why we were purchased in the next phrase of verse 11. Having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will. You know what? You can chew on this verse for all of eternity. According to Paul, we became the purchased possession of Christ simply because it was God's will that we become the purchased possession of Christ. Paul says that in eternity past, God predestined us, which simply means he marked us out. That's what predestined means. He marked us out to be Christ's redeemed possession. He made redemption, in other words, our destiny. He did it in eternity past. It was our destiny. Couldn't be avoided because God said, this is my will. And why did he do this? Well, once again, look at verse 11. Notice what Paul says. He tells us that God predestined us to be Christ's redeemed possession according to his purpose, God's purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will. In other words, God not only planned and purposed by his sovereign will that we would belong to Christ, but by his power, he works his plan out so that it becomes a reality. See, our salvation is by God's sovereign will. He chose us to become Christians, marked us out to be Christ's possession, and then used his infinite power to bring about his plan to bring us to faith in Christ, and he will complete what he began when he takes us to glory. I do like the way John Stott put this. He said Paul could hardly have insisted or said it more forcefully than our becoming members of God's new community was due neither to chance nor to choice, if by that is meant our choice, but to God's own sovereign will and pleasure. This was the decisive factor, as it is in every conversion. Now, I'd like you to notice once again this expression, who works all things after the counsel of his will. This is profound and it is deep. What this tells us is that God's election and his predestinating of us, it's not something that was random, not something that was arbitrary, as if we were chosen on a whim based on how God felt back then. While the Lord hasn't revealed to us the basis or the reason that he chooses one person and not another, we do know, based on what Paul is telling us here, we do know that there is thought and reason behind his choice. See, the word counsel, if you look at the word counsel as in the counsel of his will, that involves intelligence. That involves deliberation. It is a Greek word that actually means advice. In the sense, not that God needs advice from anybody, but it's in the sense that God advised himself. He gave our election some deliberation, some thought and reason, and on the basis of his own counsel within the Trinity, he marked us out as individuals to be saved and redeemed. I find that incredible. What a marvelous thought, because it tells us that while there is much about divine election that we just don't understand, we do know this. We do know that our election wasn't based on a whim, or as I said, how God felt at the time. It was based on his intelligent, thoughtful, and deliberate counsel. In other words, he had his reasons for choosing us. Now, as I said, what those reasons were, we have not been told. There's nothing in the Bible that says why God chose one and not another. But he did have reasons. That's the point. He did have reasons. One of his purposes, though, for choosing us to become Christ's purchased possession has been revealed to us in the next verse, verse 12. To the end that we who were the first to hope in Christ would be to the praise of his glory. Now, Paul tells us that God's ultimate purpose in choosing us to be Christ's inheritance is that we would praise his glory. What is his glory? His glory simply means the sum of his attributes, who he is. We could put it this way. It's how Peter puts it, his excellencies. In fact, Peter says this in 1 Peter 2:9, but you are a chosen race, you are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Peter is telling us we have been called out of darkness, the darkness of our own sin. We have been called out of darkness into the light. What light? The light of the glory of the gospel truth. Not only to be delivered from the horrors of hell, but so that we would, note this, for all of eternity, be praising God for who he is and for all of his remarkable attributes, especially his attribute of kindness in saving us, saving such wicked people like we are. This is essentially the same thing Paul, going back to Ephesians 1, has said back in verse 6. To the praise, he said, of the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In other words, we were saved to praise this gracious God. But I want you to notice something very significant, but something I think that's easy to overlook about what Paul has said in verse 12. Notice that he refers to a certain group of people, note this, whom he calls we who were the first to hope in Christ. Now, this is a different group from those he will mention in verse 13. Verse 13 says, in him you also, as opposed to you, we who were the first, but you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of salvation. Let me explain. In verse 12, those who were the first to hope in Christ were Jewish people, Jewish believers, who as a group heard the gospel before the Gentiles did as a group. Because Jesus came, he said, only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, came to the Jewish people. And then the apostles took the gospel only to Jewish people at first. Initially, that's what the book of Acts tells us. In fact, the church had a very hard time recognizing that Gentiles could be saved the same way Jewish people could be. Could be saved. That's what Galatians is all about. They don't need to add law to faith. They came to faith the same way that Jewish people did. So that's what the book of Acts tells us. But here, in verse 13, Paul is referring to the Gentile believers who were reading this letter, who, after listening to the message of the gospel, also believed in Christ, just like their Jewish brethren. And Paul's glorious point, let me bring this together, his glorious point is that both these groups, both Jewish and Gentile Christians, are the redeemed possession of Jesus Christ, and both have been saved to praise God for all of eternity. Now, after hearing such profound truths that we've heard tonight, that we are Christ's redeemed possession, and that God predestined us to this, because why? That was his purpose. That was his will to do it. And that he has his own intelligent reasons for choosing us, because he does all things after the counsel of his own will. After all of that, really the only thing that's left is to worship him. It's just to worship him, just to thank him, and we're going to do that in a moment, just to thank him. But if you don't know Christ, if you don't know that if you've been chosen to be redeemed, you're not sure, there is a very simple way to find out. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. If you believe on him, then you've been chosen. Come to Christ, believe in his death for your sins, and be saved and redeemed for all of eternity. That's how we know if we're chosen. But I say the only thing that's left for us to do, if you're a believer in Christ, is to just worship him. So join me as we just speak to the Lord now and praise him. Lord, we give you our praise after studying this and learning of this, that you deliberated, you thought this through in your brilliant mind, and you made a decision who you would choose. Lord, forgive us for trying to figure out election and for debating it with people endlessly, which is so fruitless. We thank you that you do all things after the counsel of your own will. And who are we to question your will, to question what you do? Lord, we come to you in obedience to this verse that we are to praise you for who you are, especially, Lord, your kindness to us. Thank you. Thank you for choosing us. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for working in our lives and bringing salvation to us and bringing us to yourself. And thank you that you who began a good work in us will continue it as you energize us and will finally someday take us home either through rapture or through death. And we thank you, Lord, for this. We thank you that you've been so kind to us. We thank you that we belong to you. And we therefore want to obey you. I pray for every believer here that you will stir their hearts, and mine included, to be absolutely obedient to you, to make sure that when we say that you are our Lord, that that means in every area of life, that's our endeavor. And when we fail, we pray you'll remind us that we need to, in every part of our lives, be yielded to you. I do pray for those who may not know Christ, that you would stir in their hearts that irresistible calling, that they would come to you, Lord, because all that the Father gives to you will come to you, and no one who comes to you will you ever cast out. So we pray you'll do that work of grace. Be glorified, Lord. We pray this in your name. Amen. Well, thank you for coming. Have a wonderful week. Go into the mission field and preach the gospel. You're dismissed.